We're going to go ahead and call the meeting to order. I'm going to wait a few more minutes, Joe.
Thank you.
The first order of business would be the minutes. That was just delivered to you, so we'll defer that so you can have an opportunity to get those unless some, I've read them, but I don't have any problem with them. I read it for more. I have to look at them myself. Let's go to the bills list. We'll defer those and we'll come back on those next court meeting. Elaine's so good about reminding me not to forget, right? You did last time. I count on you. On the bills list, there's a bills list, an additional bills list. Are there any questions? If you got any questions, run as follows. You mean?
Wait. No, already.
Otherwise, entertain a motion to pay the bills. Motion been made by Jerry, accepted by Keith. Further discussion? All approved, say aye.
Aye.
Disapproved? Motion will carry. Next would be appointments. I'm going to go through a list of appointments. If the court doesn't mind, maybe get one motion on all these, since they're really several of them are reappointments. First would be Josh Hollyfield to be reappointed to the Barstown Nelson County Tourist and Convention Commission. And this is a new appointment, Margaret Sue Masters. Anybody know Margaret Sue? You know she's a worker. Appointed to the Barstown Nelson County Tourism Commission. Cleo Phelan, I always get his name, to the Extension Board. He's a reappointment. Bill Rogers to the Extension Board, a reappointment. Bruce Reynolds is new appointment to the Barstown Nelson County Human Rights Commission. And David Floyd to the Barstown Nelson County Human Rights Commission.
I'll make a motion to approve these appointments.
Thank you, Sam. Second by Jeff Lear. Any further discussion? All approved, say aye.
Aye.
Disapproved? Motion will carry. Go ahead and sign these. Oh, whoops. Oh, I did start with that. Gosh. I'll wait. Okay. You guys have received a letter from Lincoln Trail Area Development District in your package on FEMA. You guys received that letter on FEMA?
Yes.
And then in the resolution attached to that?
Yes.
This is part, if we're going to ever receive any FEMA money in the future, we have to approve this resolution.
Is this what Brad was working on?
No.
No, it's different. This is like...
you mean John?
Remember, you missed
two of
Oh, it's been pushed over.
Where our 8-county Lincoln Trail region works together on, EMA, and then, Joe, you want to explain a little bit maybe more?
The mitigation grant, if we were to have, say, a bad storm come through, a nice storm or something of that nature, then Lincoln Trail could apply for monies representing all the counties in the region.
We've actually used it before.
To get reimbursed for some of our losses.
In particular, also that's the state transportation cabinet and everybody involved, because they're involved in this as well in our 8-county district. So I would ask this court if we could get a motion to approve this resolution. You've had the opportunity to read it, I hope.
Yes.
Thank you, Jeff.
I'll second.
Second by Sam. Any further discussion? All approved, say aye.
Aye.
Disapprove? Motion will carry. Sign this, Elaine. Anybody have a signed copy, please? Okay, on the personnel policy review to change the call-out time pay, we've discussed a couple of times before. Possibilities of moving our call-out time, in particular, it affects more the road department and our maintenance folks. Our current call-out time is 2 hours. If an employee gets called out, they come in, an alarm's going off at the Justice Center, or at Civic Center got a water leak of some sort, if they're out 15, 20 minutes, they still get paid the 2 hours. They're out over 2 hours, they get the 2 hour call out time plus the time they worked afterwards. So what I'm asking the court to is push that call out time from 2 hours to 4 hours.
How'd you come up with 4 hours?
How'd it come with 4 hours? You take, if an employee's making $20 an hour and they come out, that's $40. They're sitting down at a Thanksgiving dinner, a birthday party, or whatever, and they've got to go out and leave their family. And I figure it's worth double in today's time. If I had to have a contractor on staff or on contract to come out, a plumber or whoever, they're going to get anywhere from $80 to $100 an hour anyway.
They're not on call either, Keith. And the other part probably is that it takes half an hour to get to the job.
More.
That's what I'm basing on.
Got an estimate on what financial impact would be on a yearly basis?
Well, I can tell you, Mark and Keith combined get about $6,000 worth of overtime pay, of which part of that's regular time.
Is this going to be overtime pay?
It depends on how their work week.
If it's a holiday week, if they got to work 40 hours.
It depends. Every week's different.
Sometimes it is.
Do they alternate who's on call?
There's technically no one on call other than their own. You've got to understand, when you read the federal laws on being on call, and Sam, you probably even know this, being where you work, they do not get compensation for being on call.
Who do?
Mark and Keith.
They just get
their call out time. We don't have a technically on call person.
You've got two.
I've got two road department guys.
And we got two maintenance men. That's who they are.
But they can go. That when they go home, they also can go out to a party or whatever and say, I'm off duty.
Yeah.
It's not like Salt River or those other people where they get a financial stipend to be on call.
Yep. What I'm saying is, do they alternate weekends though?
They've tried to do it over the years, but it's gotten a little more complicated over the years too.
And the reason I say that is, it makes it a lot less difficult for the people doing the calling. That if they know this weekend, this guy's
well, we get this other maintenance man, I'll finalize the interviews on that part. Hopefully, then we'll have an alternating schedule like that.
Okay. I just know in my business, I got a 3 hour minimum on my backup. And most of the time, if I was doing work for Jim Lamont, and it only took me 15 minutes, he'll say, well, come over here, I need this done. Well, come over here, and I need that done. I'm basically there for the 3 hours. And you said 15 minutes to come in and turn the water off and pay for 4 hours. Is that right?
Well, they don't always work like that.
I know.
That's the...
Have you got a chart on how many times they get called out, like your guys? No?
You never know.
It happens in the...
They come in and work for 2 hours, they get paid for 4 hours. They come and work for 4 hours, they get paid for 4 hours. Right?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, most of the time when they come in on the road department...
Road department's different.
It's, they're in there, the time they get there and get home, it's 2 hours.
Well, I had them one night for 6 hours, so yeah. I'm a witness.
I got a call the other day.
For those guys, 2 hours is not enough.
I got a call, the alarm was going off at the Justice Center. Okay, Keith was out on sick leave, and Mark was out of town. And so I'm the third person in line. So I get the call, and when I get the call...
Did you go turn it on?
That's the reason we're bringing this up.
What am I going to do? I don't know how to do it. But by that time, Mark had called back in and said he's coming back towards town, and he would handle it. So it worked out great. It don't always work that way.
What about giving a defined benefit for the person that's on call for that week, and that way you could come up with a set amount that it's going to cost the county?
Yeah. We would be paying much more. A defined benefit would. I guarantee it. Yeah, because of that $6,000 worth of overtime, a portion of that is regular time. You understand what I'm saying?
Regular overtime, not called out overtime.
Yeah. Yeah.
Basically, this is going to be overtime because they're not.
Yeah.
They get their 80 hours every week. So this is going to be 4 hours of overtime.
I bet you we average one call out a month at the road department. So it's not overtime.
It's not a lot.
The most.
Incentive to come.
I guess it's where the most issues is at the jail.
Third maintenance guy.
The third maintenance guy will take care of most of that.
You know, would any of us get up at Thanksgiving dinner or Christmas dinner for $40?
Some of us do.
$40.
2-hour call-out time.
It's overtime hours.
Doesn't matter.
Not necessarily. You have a holiday during that week.
You got 40 hours to get overtime.
Would you get up, you have the whole family dinner for $40? You don't even get up in the morning for $100.
Thank you, Judge. I don't know if I do.
Judge, I'll make a motion. Thank you.
I'll second.
Any further discussion, Mr. Metcalf?
No, I just want to, I'm like Jeff, I'd like to know how we're going to pay for it, how much time, how much money it's going to be.
You're going to pay for it anyway.
I know, I understand that.
Motion was made by Jerry, second by Jeff.
If we don't do something.
All approve, say aye.
Aye.
Disapprove, the motion carries. It's by ordinance.
By ordinance.
Yep.
Advertise. I've got a note right there beside it.
I've got a copy of that. I'll give you a copy of that.
You did.
You got to do all that first. I tried to convince the county attorney, let me do it by order first, then do a revision later, but he suggested not that way. I'm still not here yet, Joe. He probably needs to get, okay, I was saying he needs to bed and we go on and go home, go to bed, probably. Okay, I'm going to pause here just for a second. Today, we'd like to recognize two of our emergency medical technicians, we call them EMTs. But Tim Gillum is not here today, but we have Mark Bohuski? Bohuski. I knew I'd mess it up. The Kentucky EMS Provider Challenge, the BLS division. The individual EMS teams were judged on their critical thinking skills, knowledge, and their ability to apply basic life support care in a scenario based on competition. The two competed first regionally, went on to the semifinals, and then took the win at the state competition in Lexington, Kentucky. They were awarded the trophy that will stand at the Nelson County EMS until it is passed on to the winners in next year's competition. And you can see it set in front of us. We're proud to have these two guys, but I asked Mark to come forward and get us a picture here. So it's not how fast you get to the scene, but once you get to the scene, how you apply.
That's right.
And I want to thank you for your service and all the guys and girls out there. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
You guys get a picture. Okay, we have a clerk budget amendment. Madam Clerk, you want to?
Well, I brought Madam Deputy Clerk.
Deputy Clerk to explain her.
Yeah. Gail went through caught up the differences between this year and last year.
Yeah, at the end of the third quarter, what she emailed you in the yellow is the difference so far.
You guys got a copy of that?
So rather than have a huge variance at the end of the calendar year, we'd go ahead and do a budget amendment.
I believe your excess fees were budgeted last time at 247. Did you have that right?
Yeah.
Two something, yeah.
So
your estimated excess fees this year are 353 or thereabouts. You're not going to get any complaints from that department, that's for sure. But it might be better, might be less.
Things seem to be coming ahead a little quite a bit, actually. Especially if you'll notice, and that's why I went ahead and sent us so you can see the differences in the deeds in particular.
It looks like your refunds were your biggest. You got a pretty good.
It's a wash generally.
That's all on the delinquent tax. So.
It's the way we have to collect. So, which means we end up having to return a bit of that collection. So it's a wash.
Do I have any questions from the clerk on this? Otherwise, entertain a motion to approve budget amendment. Motion has been made by Jeff Lear, second by Jerry Hahn. Any further discussion? All approve, say aye.
Aye.
Disapprove? Motion carries. You got a copy of that, right?
She'll get you a sign.
You want a sign? Well, I got you. Got it fresh? Joe, why don't you go ahead and start the EMS report and the, and talk about first the patient record and reporting software.
Okay. In your packet, you should have had a document from me referencing how we collect our patient information. Currently, and for the past 5 years, we have used a state-provided data collection system, electronic patient care reporting system, that is fully controlled by the state. We've had several issues with that over the years. We were the pilot program, which I guess still is pilot program. There's about six or eight services in the state that still use the state-provided program. It was updated about 18 months ago, which took us from a fairly easy user program to a very difficult and cumbersome program that also affected our billing software. As you know, our billing software is the hub of the service, and if we're not getting the proper information pulled into billing software from what the crews are doing on the street, then it greatly hinders our ability to fully collect our revenues. So we have been talking for some time, Judge and I talked about it last year. We budgeted money in last fiscal budget, but we worked with the state a little bit longer, and we still weren't real sure what program would be best. We researched three separate programs. One was actually ImageTrend, which is what we're using today, but we would buy the license and be able to control it through in-house. That came up to be about a $23,000 project for us if we wanted to go that route, continue using what we do but have more control. The other one program was put out by a company called Zoll. Zoll does heart monitor equipment, and they're also in the electronic patient care reports program. They came in at a quote with $20,256. Around us, the counties that have joined us, many of them already use the third quote that we got called ESO. The difference between ESO, Zoll, and ImageTrend, the biggest part of the money difference is in the training. ImageTrend and Zoll both require a minimum of amount of training at a significant cost, almost half what the startup cost is. ESO has online training, and as I said, me, Marion, LaRue, Hardin, Washington counties are already using ESO, so some of our guys moonlight with those services and already familiar with it. So our online training is significantly less, and our startup cost for it is $11,997 for the first year, and then we're billed. It's a web-based program, so we're billed per run for the years following that at $1.50 a run.
But we're already paying a software price.
We're already paying for that through ImageTrend, even though the state provides it. We're paying $3,000 a year through ImageTrend for that service. So. I've talked to our staff. We have had two demos of both of these, Zoll and ESO. We've had two demos of that in the past 6 months. We did budget again this year to do that, and I would recommend that we move to the ESO program.
Everybody understand the importance of this of this computer program? The billing process is so important in the medical field. It's not like billing at the jail or another department we may have, a landfill. You go through the medical insurance programs, right. The insurance companies.
ICD-10 codes now. But what happens is when the crew goes out and makes a run, they're filling out this computer-based patient care report. It goes up to the cloud, the web, and then the hospital can pull that information back into their record, and we pull the information back into our billing software. So it's a streamlined function that pretty much does away with paper on the patient side.
And nearly $2 million for the billing we do a year, this is important.
Let's see, so you got billed quarterly, not the $11,997, divide that by four?
They have agreed, because I negotiated with them that we are in the middle of our fiscal year. They normally bill you at the beginning of the year, but they've agreed to bill us quarterly. So we will have two quarters to pay for the rest of this year.
So we divide that $12,000 up?
Yep, by four.
By four, okay.
Okay, going forward, we'll use this program, it'll be $12,000 annually.
$12,000 annually plus what? You said so much per run?
No, that is, actually be less than $12,000 annually after the initial startup. They have us projected between, they do groups of runs, we're in the group of $5,000 to $6,500, and our billing rate for that would be $10,071, and then there's a constant cardiac monitor fee, $800, so it would be about $11,000 quarterly bill starting July 1.
$11,000 annually bill quarter.
Yeah, and that dollar 50 runs included in that $12,000.
Yes, the $5,000.
I can see Jeff.
Well, the way he's got it wrote on there, it kind of looks like it.
When he explained it to me the other day.
Well, that's what I'm sitting here calculating, what it's going to take to do this.
Even on top of that. But this is something we have budgeted.
Right, we budgeted $12,000 last year's budget and carried that over in this year's budget.
Need a motion to approve going with the billing company of ESO? Motion been made by Jeff, second. McKee?
Let me correct it for the record. The electronic patient care report program, our billing company is our...
Yeah, that's what I meant, yeah, electronic.
I just want to make sure we get that.
I'm sorry.
We use Tri-Tech for our billing.
That was my acronym problem. Motion been made by Jeff, second by Keith. All approved, say aye.
Aye.
Disapproved, motion will carry.
I know my staff is going to thank you much for that because they really have a hard time with the current program we're using.
If it catches enough billing here, you pay for itself very easily.
Give more corrected information.
Your regular monthly report, Joe, before we...
Regular monthly report, you have a copy of for October, 632 calls were made, 130 of those were non-transport, and 28 times we had in stations had to come back into Bardstown Station for coverage in the month. That was up a little bit from the previous month. As it compares to last year, we're, you know, 631 calls last year. As you can see, the trend, as you look at this report, the last 18 months to 2 years, as Obamacare came into play, you see a significant impact on our run volume, and that's the only thing we can really contribute to.
Okay. Under EMS report, about a few weeks ago, I think Joe, we gave them a copy of this recruitment and retention proposal and had discussions about that, and after some long thinking about what we're up against of trying to retain our paramedics and EMTs, I suggested to Joe that we not only look at this year, what we could do to improve this, for our folks, but how can we retain them for the future and help recruit for the future, not just 1 year, but 2 and 3 years down the road. We had success doing this in other departments over the years by looking at the long term, not being short-sighted, so I am proposing to the court to go, the proposal that Joe has in place here, the EMT's going up from $10.75 starting to $12 an hour, that would be, I would propose to be effective December the 1st, I think what we talked about, is that right, Rhonda? December 1st. And then look at an additional $1 an hour increase for 2017, and another $1 an hour increase for 2018. On those positions across the board. And that would take us to the point that, well, if we're going to pay out this, how are we going to bring in the revenue to support it? So we go to the last page, second. Here's the last page. Last page of the report that Joe passed out, you did pass that out, didn't you? It shows the fee runs and what they cost per run. Looks like this, guys. All along, we've talked about the need to keeping up all of our fee-based services, whether it be garbage, whether it be any other type of service, keeping those services whole without further digging into the tax dollars. And when you have an opportunity to pay for it that way, it needs to be dealt with that way. And so I'm proposing an increase in the fees to cover those costs. And those fees will be covered over the next, 3 years. Understand what I'm talking about?
You're going to give a dollar per year?
Immediately, we'll go to a dollar and a half.
Dollar
and a quarter, I'm sorry. Then a dollar and a half on the paramedics. Then a dollar on the shift leaders, a dollar on COVID specialists. Then we create two new positions, or titles, EMT Advanced, I believe that's what it's called.
EMT Advanced.
And then Critical Care Paramedic. You want to explain those two positions? But they're just new titles.
In the past few years, due to the paramedic shortage, Kentucky Board of EMS adopted a national accredited program to include an advanced EMT. And what it does, it takes, and Mark is, as a matter of fact, the only Nelson County EMT that has attended that training and is an advanced, or is going to be our first advanced EMT, hopefully. But it takes an EMT and puts someone in between the EMT and the full licensed paramedic. It's still a certification program, not a license like a paramedic, but the advanced EMT can help a lot in our ALS transfers, our advanced life support transfers. They have a higher level of education than the basic EMT, so they can do a lot of things that would free up a paramedic to be able to do additional higher level skill level thing. So there's a definite need there to help us with our transfers more than anything to keep our medics in the county, since our medic numbers are dropping off. The critical care paramedic is an endorsement that a licensed paramedic can get when if they want to fly on the helicopter or they want to take additional, we as the service would have to come up with some additional equipment. But at the point in time we feel that we're there, this would already be in place, and we have two paramedics, licensed paramedics that are part-time that have critical care endorsements, and that allows them to give better treatment and use more equipment in the advanced level than a normal licensed paramedic would do.
And you guys see the emails ever so often about the Jewish hospital, or one of the hospitals, bragging on the guys out here and girls out here for making decisions out in the field that save people's lives. And I can really put a dollar value on that kind of stuff. Obviously, we have to be cognitive of the cost. So if you go on the last page of that, it shows the proposed fee increases that would be required to cover those costs. Questions?
For the rest of the year, what's it going to do to the budget?
Well, that's what, if you look at the revenue that for 6 months, the first $91,000, that's what we'll, and we want to propose that to be approved shortly. Like ASAP, right, Rhonda?
Exactly.
Because it takes 2 months or 60 to 90 days for it to kick in to the billing cycles because of the Medicare, Medicaid, and all that stuff.
And we're expecting about the same increase in wages and related benefits in 6 months, 7 months.
It shows here, Keith, the first year. Let me get my numbers here. Shows the increase per year. It averages about $90,000 to $100,000 a year.
We don't have that. Huh?
It's attached to it. Was it? Should be.
It
went out in a packet. Yeah.
Earlier.
Okay. Even this update that. Okay.
That information.
Okay. It went out in a packet. This was the addition on the revenue.
Right.
It's a little complicated there, but it's not that. You're giving more revenue, more money to the folks for their service, and you're charging more for the service. So you know it's what we all work towards to make it a whole.
We normally
service.
Do a fee cost adjustment about every January. 12 or 14 months. The last one was in February 2015 that we actually did a fee adjustment.
Okay.
And Joe, this actually puts us, you know, not, I mean, our surrounding counties, we're not in Atlanta.
I gave you all a copy of the comparison to our surrounding counties, and you have to look at those fees for service for surrounding counties based on their run volume and their population too. So in our...
Two or three of these counties are half our size and they're higher than we are.
Right.
They don't have anybody here to make it.
I'm okay with it.
But we're not going to do the tuition cost share at present.
Well, we need to look, we would have to draft some language to protect us on that. And we're not opposed to that. You know, that's what I'm saying, we don't want to get somebody trained and they leave.
I would like to get a little more information because...
Yeah, I don't want to pay for somebody schooling and him up and jump and run to Breckenridge or Harden or somewhere else.
And that possibility, and especially in the paramedic, because of the shortage exists. It's a very competitive field for our paramedics today that we didn't have 2 years ago.
Has that just changed with the hospitals they've gone to? I remember you saying that the last meeting.
Last 12, 18 months.
Do you, media, remember Joe talking about the paramedics are going to hospitals now to be able to work inside there? Okay, at this time, I'd entertain a motion to approve the increases for the personnel as presented, and further, in that same motion, approve the rate increases as proposed. Motion by Jerry Hans, or second?
I'll second.
Second by Jeff. You got you a little bit faster there. All approved, say aye. Disapproved. Motion will carry.
I just want to ask another question, but I guess we don't have further discussion.
I forgot to discuss. Yeah, I'll be glad to answer Jeff's question.
I just didn't see a breakdown on increased revenue versus increased cost.
It's not, yep.
I didn't get what you showed me.
I made a copy.
You didn't make a copy of this one you gave me, this one you said you had a copy for?
I did not make this one. Those pages you have.
No, I didn't get that.
It's by employee, so you don't really get it.
I'm just looking bottom line.
Bottom line is on
Looks like it.
The first year you're going to expend $88,000 more, and you're going to take in 91. Right? Second year you're going to expend $100,000 more, and this is just personnel cost. You will take in 122.
That's salaries, benefits, everything.
Yes. And then third year it's basically you can gain another $20,000, but we figured third year your fuel cost, I mean, everything goes up, so that's the only way we can make it work and be safe.
Aye.
But you had to, we gave you the last court meeting the basic principle of this, but I went further out.
Yeah.
So there's no use to do it 1 year at a time and have them come back here and they start leaving again or start thinking about it. This way they can plan their future with us and hope this helps.
I'd say don't come back again.
I think this puts us in better. I can tell you, we did this with the sheriff's department about 20 years ago. We did it with a jail. 20 years ago, a lot of turnover, Dorcas, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Okay, thank you all so much for that.
Thanks a lot from our department.
Next was the syringe exchange program through the health department. This was a draft resolution that Sarah sent me the other day. No action technically needed on today. I need her to doctor it up on the numbers, on the insert the data, where it says insert the data here. I am going to recommend the court in our next court meeting to approval on this. I want to get the numbers for you. Jeff and I talked about this yesterday. I'm kind of on the fence whether I support this or don't support it. And Jeff, I think all the guys kind of had those emotions, didn't you?
I just don't like it bringing into our streets. Anytime you give anything away free, it's going to bring people in on the streets.
I think most of our counties are going to go to this eventually.
Are they going to?
The city has to approve it too, by the way.
They're going to get into the specifics of the program as far as...
Sarah, I'll get that for you guys between now and then for me. But this was, I got this a couple days ago, and I wanted to send it, I think, Friday, Thursday before I left.
How many people, how many counties is done in Kentucky right now?
I'd say 15, I think.
Is that what it is?
I think it was 15. That's what they
said. Your bigger counties.
You're trying to get ahead of the curve. you know, to prevent the maintenance.
The bad thing about it's here now, whether you like it or whether you don't.
Is whether you do it.
Keith, I'm on that health board, one of the big benefits, now they say it's going to help stop diseases and things like that, that's out of my area of expertise, I don't have a clue on that. But the part I did like about it was, is when they do come in there, and I didn't like this program at first, but talking to Sergio, when they come in there, they have to talk to people. And so they can get into counseling a lot better. And then when they come in there to get the exchanges, they got a problem, they know they got a problem. They don't know where to go. And so this is the big benefit of it, and I don't think they're pushing it hard enough, being that this is a big benefit. It doesn't sound like a great program to me, looking at exchange needle, but if you get this person coming in.
The opportunity for counseling becomes greater.
And that's the big deal, that they can quantify the numbers.
If they want, if they want.
On that.
But you see, the health department reluctant to push that because it'll drive the folks.
They don't mandate it, but they, these people that come in are, when you come in for needles, you're hurting, right?
I don't see that it's helped Louisville that much.
I don't know about that.
I think the Indiana, let's use Indiana as the example, that's where the epidemic happened. They were behind on the curve. They waited too late almost to get it started, so they're going to have a time of recovery before they see it. There were 30 or 40 HIVs and that, just in that small area there. That was a lot.
That's the disease prevention, I'm not sure about all that.
That's why the health department's stepping in with hepatitis and HIV is the main reason.
It doesn't sound, like I say, it sounds.
I'll get you more detail, I'll get you an update.
Not good, but.
Sergio will be here at our next board meeting. I don't know if y'all cover it or not.
Not bad.
It's a tough thing.
Any other questions?
For a small rural county type thing too.
Jail report.
Today we have a total of 136 inmates. We have 5 home incarceration, 30 state inmates. We have 8 serving weekends, one of those is a state. And then we have an in-house total of 123. For the month of October, controlled intake, we average 23 a day. Class Ds, we average 15 a day. Nelson County, we averaged 105 a day. So our total average, daily average for October was 144. The new release, arrest and releases on arrivals, we had 143 males, 60 females, so a total of 203. Releases, we had 154 males, 62 females. That was a total of 216. And sentenced inmates in district court, we have 15 that have been sentenced. On serving weekends, we have 7 out of district. Waiting for court, we have 19. Most of those is probably going to be to the grand jury. Home incarceration, of course, we have 5. Work release, we have 3. And on our state salary, we have controlled intake 21, class D's 19. We have 6 of those are doing community service, 5 on work release. We have 1 that's serving jail time and circuit. We have 4 off from drug court serving time. We have 1 from Shelby County and 1 from Anderson County who work. They live in Nelson and they work other places, but they wanted to come to Nelson County Jail to do their work release. They're paying their total, their board, looking for everyone, even their medical, but we're housing those 2. Circuit court, waiting for court, we have 45, so we have a total of 64 that has not been sentenced.
Folks, how's the rocket docket working out for you guys? Matthew
probably came more because we don't see that end of it.
We're doing it every week in terms of what impact we have, and like I explained in the beginning, it's like pulling your hand out of a bucket of water. I don't know how you're going to see what it's going to look like until we run the numbers, but you know, every week offers are being made and being accepted, and guys are going through it, people are going through it, so we'll see.
That's not like we would know if they got sentenced to county jail.
Why do you don't see them?
And the majority of your Rocket docket, Jeff, is going to be, you know, people who get some type of diversion usually, so they wouldn't be taken out of incarceration.
Okay. Dorcas, since we found out that the jail is not in the city of Bardstown, I thought it'd be appropriate if we consider removing your jail employees from paying the city's occupational tax. And since we're not going to get support from the city in that aspect, we very seldom ever ask for that support. That might be a problem. We might need to sit down after the court meeting and talk about that.
Interesting.
Landfill solid waste report.
I submitted the NOI, which is notice of intent to apply for the solid waste landfill expansion, which is about a 550-page application. So it's good to get that off the plate and start on the next process, which is.
It looked like a lot of boilerplate stuff. You have to go around and read and make sure you build it in the right hole.
Yeah. Yeah.
I bet you're hating that, aren't you?
It's education.
Right, cool. He's learning.
And the places I don't need it.
John, take a look like that. That's what you're going to need.
That's the easy part of the application process. The next one's, what, 3,000 pages?
The deficiency is going to get back.
So we also sold some surplus equipment, which brought pretty good pricing.
My old blue baby?
Mm-hmm.
Gone.
Did you guys get a summary on that?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, that's it. About $5,000 for that tractor.
5610 for the tractor, which is good. I was pleased with it.
The fairground might have a couple out there. I got some bait. I think I got some twins to that one out there. Road department report.
All right, couple things. First, I'll go through my report. Bush Hogan, we finished District 2 for the fifth round. We're going to trim a little bit in District 1, but then we're going to winterize. We're not trimming now because we're back to patching. We got some calls about some problems in Thompson Hill Road and things like that, and the weather's nice and Mago's still making asphalt, so we decided to go and do a little more patching. But it's tough because you got to get exactly what you need because Mago's doing base. They mix it up ahead of time. So anyway, we're going to finish this week with, there won't be any more asphalt patching after tomorrow probably, the way it's looking. Boom mowing's down while we're patching. It takes 9 guys, but we're going to be boom mowing back. We'll be in District number 3. We finished District 1, and we're going into District 3. And we'll just go all winter that way and just move into the districts as we can. General work that they did, the voting machines takes 2 days. The crews move those around for a successful election, I guess, just depending on what side you're on, you know, so. It was successful for her because there was no controversy, right?
67% turnout.
So anyway, we're putting up signs, taking down some trees, getting caught up. Winter's slow as long as it doesn't snow, so that's good. We've ordered 430 tons of salt. Brad's been calling Morton Salt. That's a new company, but they're a big corporation. They keep promising us, supposed to be in Louisville, they just trying to line up their truck haulers to get it to here. But we got 1,600 tons, we got plenty of salt, but 430 will fill the new salt barn up. So that has been ordered. We got we got a new dually in, and it should be ready hopefully by the end of this week. So you'll have 3 duallys. We use 3 four-wheel drive vehicles to do subdivisions, small streets, dead-end roads. This dually's going to replace a 3/4-ton truck that was kind of overloaded, so we'll have 3 duallys plowing also. Got 7 dump trucks and 3 duallys, and it works well, getting all the roads hit, plowed once in a workday, you know, so it works out real well. Brad will get to handle all that.
Do you have to do a new box for that?
No, we used the box off the other one.
Yeah, the 3/4-ton truck's going to, the bed's going to be taken off and the tool bed's going to be put on it, and it's going to be a take-home foreman truck because it's a four-wheel drive.
We already got the used bed for it.
Yeah, and then we got another four-wheel drive cut truck coming in. It's been bought, but it's not in yet. So these trucks take forever to get here nowadays through Ford. They're backed up, I guess. A couple things. Green Chapel Road, we got an issue on a culvert. It's a 4x6 box culvert that we're going to have to work on. It can be a winter job. the edges of it have fallen off. It's actually a block walled culvert, real old thing.
Concrete cinder block?
It's, yeah, and it's, the edges are broken, so we've put signage out there and stuff like that, but it's going to have to be replaced.
10 feet, 12 feet?
It's a 60-foot long culvert.
60 foot.
But from a hydraulic standpoint, a corrugated metal pipe will work, a 66-inch pipe, it's about $6,000 to $7,000 is what we're looking at.
Just a proposal, that's it.
Yeah, and Brad's, the hydraulics, he's going, I've got the report.
Sized.
Sized and stuff, and he's going to go through it and make sure and but it looks like a $6,000 or $7,000 culvert versus a reinforced concrete thing that takes forever to get done and bid out and all that kind of stuff. So it's not as big of an area, but it's still a pretty substantial lick. But there's not, it has to be done. You know, it's something we can't ignore. It was pointed out to us last week, I guess.
Wait, have you sent the pictures on that?
It's new.
Okay.
So.
Okay, I don't remember very many. Concrete monkeys.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird. They're all green chap.
Green chap.
You seen?
Inlet and outlet in a boat messed up. That's the outlet. And this block was pushed out.
Okay.
This one for some reason. Well, we blocked it to make it.
Real.
That's bad.
And I've seen that one going up.
It's not something you can go in and shore up.
Well, the new culvert, it would fit inside.
No, it won't tear it out. But it's a loop road, so we can get it out. But now it can be done this winter. A lot like it, you know, it can be done in cold weather, so it's a terrible thing, so.
It's a cost on it, so. It just has to be in old Jerry's district.
I'd say it's in Nelson County, so I don't.
That's right, that's right.
Yeah, yeah. It gets called, you go and ask, you say that, you used to call it by district.
Speaking of Green Chapel, in about two more days, we should be done with the railing slash cribbing process. Depending on weather and their paving, we may go up there and put a patch on it because the asphalt's cracked, but yeah, we now want to, Murphy Lane, we're just getting started. That's the main one of the two.
Is that project going for you?
Yeah, it's a real interesting process if you ever see it. I mean, you see why it costs what it costs when you see their equipment they're using.
Are they pinned like they did it?
No, it's rails. So they drill down, hit rock, go another 10.
It's like what now?
Not the pinning.
A railroad.
No, it's not the pinning. It's different.
That was different.
I'll get you guys pictures and stuff of it.
Bunch of stuff.
Of how it works. Just right in the middle of it.
Basically, ground piles.
Cribbing guardrail.
Yeah.
About 6 foot down. And it's just a retain, it's like a big retaining wall. Keeps it from pushing.
It's placed the trees and so on.
Yeah.
Basically.
Probably as much blacktop we put on it, put on it. They're done paint.
Murphy Lane had 3 foot. That's what it rocked. Anything else, Jim?
Yeah, one thing, asphalt cold mix, we usually get quotes this time of year to get cold mix prices. I was waiting on the state bids it out. And I got the prices yesterday afternoon about 5:30. Nagel's usually the best quote, so we just get it from them, right? But they want low coat this year. The guy out of Cincinnati was. And we can't, sometimes we have problems out of the cold mix. It doesn't do well. So Mabel has to come and get it and replace it for us. They're not going to do that out of Cincinnati. So what I would recommend is that we go with the high performance mix, the quote of $120 a ton. It's another $1,000, $1,500.
Eaton did bid the high performance mix.
I don't have their whole bid, but I don't guess so. I don't know. All's I got, like I said, these bids came out late, and I just got the report yesterday afternoon. But it's running late in the year where I need to order this stuff.
Didn't we up that last year because you liked the better mix a little bit better?
We ran out of the KP6, and Mago brought me some high performance for the same price as 110. It worked fine. It was fine. It stays workable through the winter. The state's gone to a hot box. It's a trailer with burners. Because the KP6 mix gets too stiff in the wintertime and you can't do nothing with it. We don't have that. I don't want to buy one of those. I wouldn't want to buy one. It's kind of whatever. But the high performance is what you can buy at Lowe's in bags. It's the same type of stuff, so it's easier, you know, it stays more pliable where they can fill it in the cold winter time.
I think we need to go with the high performance mesh. We had issues with that other ones before, about 3 years ago.
Oh, I've had Magos come back, y'all probably don't realize, they've replaced some of that KP6 every year because we get loaded stiff and you can't drive a shovel in it, and they just do it.
You had that OB in pool one time they came and got it.
Yeah, so, you know, if I had that problem out of Cincinnati, you just didn't.
Let's do the bid on the high performance.
100 tons?
Yes.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the high performance mix with Magos Construction.
All right, second to that, Gary Hines. Any further discussion? All approve, say aye.
Aye.
Disapprove? Motion carry.
One little simple thing, South Steelwell Road turnaround, Keith, did you ever?
I rode down there, that lady was not at home. Did you ever find out who the property owners was on the right?
I've got another stuff here, I'll give it to you after.
He was supposed to tell me if it was who I thought it was.
It's not a Walbridge.
Okay.
Somebody else, they bought it from the Walbridge. Woolridge or Walbridge?
Yeah, Woolridge.
Woolridge. Edlin, maybe, Yogi? Never heard of that name, Yogi Junior?
All right.
That's the name on the tax thing, so. But anyway, I'm gonna give you this information if you can.
Tyler, you're on.
You update on some projects we're doing. We're cleaning out the fence line there against football between us and the Ballards. Also, there's some picture there, Dave Cook finished the brick wall there for us.
Backstop?
On the backstop there for baseball.
Did you get it sealed?
We haven't got it sealed yet. We're gonna seal that one, and we're gonna seal the top one up on the one that he did before.
It'll be a good time to seal before the rain.
We're gonna get both those sealed, and then you can see that the sod that we put down on that field, it came in real nice.
It's good.
And then we resurfaced that softball field, and it did really well.
How far around are you going on that walking trail as far as cleaning out?
We're gonna go all the way down to that hill mound right behind Bethel's field, and then we're gonna come back down the side of the retention pond, clean up down through there.
That's a big improvement there. Any comments from your walkers on it?
It's good, probably, if anybody's ever been up front, there's a lot of people that walk out there. I was out there.
We haven't had a lot of walkers the last few days, kind of been chilly in the morning.
Fair weather for walkers.
Fair weather. But that's the main thing, but most of the projects have been finishing up, and the only thing left on that lower field is to put in the drainage pipe. Just haven't got to it yet. We wanted to get that other stuff cleaned up since all the grass and everything's dying off, and it's a little easier to get to.
Okay, let's go to under old new business. Have a report that Fair Board has received a $100,000 grant from the Department of Agriculture. I think Keith, you actually got a personal phone call from the commissioner himself, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Right. Quails, is that the name?
Quarles.
A part of that is that the Fair Board is also gonna ask the county to contribute financially to that upgrade of the Samuels Hall. I met with the Fair Board the other day and suggested the only way I could recommend to the court to go along with that, if they turn that money over to the fiscal court and let us bid out the project and supervise the project from an engineering perspective and an accounting perspective with Rhonda, so we don't get in the situation we got in before. And they're gonna need about another $37,000, $40,000 or so. And they have, what, 9 months to complete the project, I think, Keith? So what I'm gonna do is bring up, I'm gonna get together, I've already put Brad and John on notice that we're gonna put a project together and let you guys look at it and see if you would approve the balance of that money to come.
So we're gonna get a $100,000 grant, and then we've gotta put up $40,000. So it's a $140,000 renovation.
Renovation of Samuels Hall. That would include
a new front on it and painting the outsides, some new doors, windows, some new walls, interior walls, bathroom renovations. Make it a little more ADA accessible. But I want to make you aware of it, so we're going to bring you back a project to look at in the near future. Okay?
But also put like a little addition on the back for the green work program.
Oh, yeah, on the backside, Sam, over there, when you suggested this one time, possibly that. You suggested over there at the tail end of the building to go out a little piece and make us a storage room there for our balance of our food instead of sticking in that closet we're having to stick it in right now.
Yep.
Feed America program, we've been doing it for 4 years, so I know we're going to stay in it for a while. Once you start something like that, it's kind of hard to, and I enjoy doing it. And I think the community Rotary Clubs and Heaven Hills and all the volunteers that participate in that enjoy doing it, so, and it helps the people in the community. So all that will maybe be included in that. And Sam suggested maybe a walk-in cooler somewhere along the line where we could store more of our frozen foods.
What do we do with that now?
Right now, we time it as close as we can. We actually had to take it back to E10 on a couple occasions. We've got a couple small freezers. If we have a small amount left, we can store it. We got the two freezers, Sam, that's helped out a lot.
Yeah, the walk-ins. We haven't
had
expensive.
And here lately, we've had limited supply of meats anyway, so that may not be an issue in the future.
Yeah, we just got minimum 20 cases of frozen food that we can take care of.
Yeah.
But we get a pile of food.
Then you're out of luck.
Yeah, then we have to take it back to E-Town. We've done
it. Who's doing this month?
This month is St. Gregory's Lend a Hand program. Okay. We'll have 70 volunteers there.
When you got to spend this money for this renovation?
9 months.
December?
You got the award about a week or two ago, so sometime about this time of year.
Excellent.
I mean, about
so it'd be a good project to get after the fair.
Right.
After or before?
Oh, it'd be done.
It'd be done before.
2017.
After,
but
after the fair.
9 months from the date of the award. That's what you told me the other day.
That's going to be before the fair.
But it's going to be tough to get it done before the fair is what I'm getting at.
Well, if it's 9 months and it's been awarded.
Well, we'll work those details out, bring back to you. The next court meeting, you will have something in your hands.
Okay.
Right, John?
Yep.
Along with that 5,000 report?
5,000 paper report?
Might be on a post-it note.
I filled out two papers last night. It took me about 30 minutes.
You guys have anything to report on or ask? Anybody?
I'd like to do a little election thing. Would you like to hear about elections?
County clerk has a report. Yes, always.
It's not actually a report, but I would kind of like to do a little updating on as far as election work and business is concerned, and send out some gratitude to, number one, to my staff, because we've shuffled workers and lost a couple of key players in our election staff over there. So this has probably been, I've never worried as much in my life as I did about this particular election. We have 33,000 registered voters for 24 precincts, and a pretty heavy number in each precinct. So you worry about voting machines holding up when they get to the polling place. There's a long, long, long line of work that has to be done in preparation for the election. You start, if we were going to have an election next year, we do have an off year, we would already be starting filings for the next election. So that's
there's no election at all in the spring, right?
No election in 2017. Thank you.
That's a good thing financially and all. Yeah.
We won't see harp on our deal, right?
No, but the bills for this one probably are gigantic, and the county ends up paying the biggest part of those, because we get a little bit of money from the state depending on how many registered voters we have, and we get I think the law states up to 50 cents per voter to pay for expenses. It doesn't touch expenses, so well, it might touch on
An election cycle is over $100,000 now.
Yeah, it's very good.
The whole cycle,
and we get very little generation. Mm-hmm. There's not much money back except for the filing fees and that, but that doesn't amount to much. At any rate, the people on the list that I honestly have to mention as far as being thankful. Road Department delivers those machines, picks them up. As Jim said, it's a two-day job, and they just do an excellent job. And they are very careful with the machines, from what we can tell. They have their rotation down nearly perfectly. So, but it takes several days even prior to that to get our supplies to St. Monica. We do an inspection of voting machines. The County Board of Elections inspects machines. That's two or three trips by the time we get them set up and the inspections. And you've got to understand, setting up voting machines is just not going out and setting up voting machines. We have to make certain, especially an election like we just had, that we do this day in and day out, that people are coded depending on what school district they live in, what magisterial district they live in, whether or not they live in any one of the four cities. Every single 33,000 people in this county are coded as to where they vote. And so that's the job that our girls do with the help of computer systems now, but that's evolved over a period of time. The Board of Elections, Lisa Pinkston is our Democratic board member, Alma Jean Burba is the Republican board member, Sheriff Mattingly and the county clerk are members of the Board of Elections. We're in session from 6 to 6. We're actually in session from 5 till we get out of there at night.
It's a long day.
It is a long day.
I feel bad for you.
Well, and you know, it's part of the job, and we don't mind that part of the job. It's not the biggie. Clay Blanchett, and we brought in a new person, Roman Harden, to help with the technology, and it is the greatest relief on earth to have Clay and his knowledge, but Roman, who can get out there and take care of things very rapidly, and he was a big help.
I was over there election day, and they were going out to a precinct on a run.
To Boston, on
fixing the machine.
We had two precincts that actually called in because they had paper jams. Well, it turned out both of those was basically a little bit of an error on the part they were fixed within a few minutes. The other thing that's happened, and if you all read the standards report on the 1996 elections, and I recall this, they were talking about standing in line for like half an hour to 45 minutes. That wouldn't have been an irritation in my book this year because I was kind of expecting that. But we divide our rosters so that we can run two lines through. The slowest part of that process, if we don't get a machine foul, is getting people to sign the roster and get through. The second big job is that we have five huge precincts, or five major splits in precincts. We have the city of New Haven, Fairfield, and Bloomfield are split precincts, but there's five precincts within the city of Bardstown that are split in four different ballots, so that some people are strictly a county school, some people are strictly a city school, and then you have both those schools possibly connected to the city of Bardstown. So those poll workers really have to be on their toes to catch the codes in our books and to be able to hand the voters
and give them the right sheet
ballot. Exactly. And we did have a couple of mistakes, but very, very few. The bottom line there is on the voter. The voter has to understand what his ballot should be, what he's eligible to vote for, and he has to stop that if he is handed the wrong ballot. And we did have that happen a time or two. But once it's voted, it's over. It is over. So we had
to.
So I guess my message is, and then on top of everything else, the state determined that we could do voter registration by way of computer. We walked in there a couple of weeks prior to the election, within a week of having our deadlines, where we have to have everything done, with 900 applications that we had to process. So not that you mind doing the work, but when it hits you, I think Jefferson County had maybe 12,000. That is such a struggle for the guys at the bottom of the poll who are doing the work and holding the things
together. So you had 900
applications
that deadline.
Not all, pretty much, had not been processed. And a majority of them came through that online, and a lot of them are redundant, a lot of them are, but regardless of redundancy, you still have to look at all of them. So we pulled in girls that don't normally do the job, and we got it completed. I thought we might have to do a little overtime, but the girls pulled together and they did it, and I just have to give them a lot of credit. So that's my message. I wanted to thank the Board of Elections, those election officers who literally did a super job, and for all the time I wasted worrying about this election, it came off like clockwork. It was beautiful, actually. And it's such a relief that it's over. So that's kind of the message. But you know, the real message is people need to understand how much work is involved in election, how much room for error there is in the election process.
And how much cost goes into election. I mean, taxpayers are paying for it, everybody needs to be aware of it. I mean, it's compared to what it was 25 years ago.
It's extreme.
About $100,000.
We probably...
You don't know the real cost, because HARP keeps sending invoices.
Well, it's not HARP. You never see what it costs our office. I'm a full-time girl.
Yeah, yeah. And you could add more to that.
Yeah, I mean...
No, but your folks are staff anyway.
They are staff, but they're spending a good two-thirds of this past year, and maybe more, doing nothing more than elections. The other thing is that the precinct officers, that's $22,000 to $25,000, and we put two extra precinct workers in every precinct almost, because we were so concerned about the burden of how many voters would be there. So at any rate, it's just an educational process, but I do appreciate all the folks that put the time and effort into it.
Okay,
thank you.
Anybody else?
Thank you, Lane, and all your staff for
one informational thing.
Joe?
Just for the court to know, we're scheduled to construct New Haven Tire Saturday. We'll be doing some preliminary site work this week. Barn rain or weather event, we'll be there with the crane.
It's supposed to be high on that Saturday.
Yeah, just wanted to extend an invitation to the court and to you, Judge. Our annual Christmas dinner is December 10th. Cocktails start at 6, mm-hmm. The meals at 7, so love for you guys to be there. Bring your spouses.
Where is that?
It's going to be at the Knights of Columbus Hall on 4th Street. Yeah.
Get your directions, Joe. Yeah,
this way. But you're all, we'd love to have you.
I got three places to be that night.
You always do, Judge.
Yeah. I try to rotate.
I know.
I try to rotate. Anything else, guys?
Motion to adjourn?
Yes.
Motion by Sam, second by Keith Metcalf. All approved, say aye.
Aye.
Disapproved? Motion will carry. Thank you all.